My guest with me today needs no introduction, Dame Ellen MacArthur. And thank you for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
For all of us here, could you kind of take us back to your childhood, give us a few minutes on what got you going, the catalysts early on in your career to kind of choose the path you went down?
I guess first and foremost, I was the most unlikely sailor probably to come out of this country because I grew up in Derbyshire, right in the middle of the UK. I was not at all from a sailing background. None of my family sailed, apart from my auntie Thea. And when I was 4 years old, she gave me the opportunity to go and sail on her boat with my brother and my grandma, and we travelled down to the East Coast. And I will never, ever forget that feeling I had as that four-year-old. I remember the excitement, not just at seeing the boat, but actually seeing the sea, which, you know, for a kid from the country was a really big deal. And then rowing out the boat in the mud, and then getting on board the boat and looking into this tiny little cabin and realizing, you know, this could take us anywhere in the world. And that was that feeling of freedom that I've never lost, that feeling of this boat can take us anywhere. And when we sailed, that all came to life. You know, you hoist the sails and off you go. And I was fascinated by it. As a very small child, it became, you know, the thing that I drew on all my school books. There were little pictures of boats everywhere. I just wanted to learn all I could about it because I thought it was the most amazing thing I'd ever done.
And so how did you keep that passion alive when you went back to Derby and you went back to school and the winter was there and you couldn't see the sea? Because I guess most sailors, they grow up around the water, they fall in love with the water and they interact with the water all the time. Like, how did you keep the passion alive from such a young age?
I think a true passion doesn't need keeping alive in a way. It's there. It's just something that it's triggered and it's there. It's like a chemical reaction. And for me, perhaps being a long way away from the sea made me yearn for it more. And I just spent all my time reading sailing books. And I started saving my school dinner money from the age of 8 for a boat every single day. And I would pile up the change on top of my little square money box. When that pile reached a pound, I would drop it in and cross off 100 squares I'd drawn on a piece of paper because it got me closer to the water. And in reality, it was a few pence in a tin. But actually, for me, it was something I could do to get me closer to that goal. Because, you know, even back then, one day, somehow, I wanted to sail around the world.
And so what were the challenges, like when you hit the teenage years, I guess one of the first big things you did was to kind of go around the UK single-handed. Like, what were as a teenager, what were the challenges that you had to overcome? I guess from a diversity standpoint, being a woman in the sailing, did you feel like you had obstacles there? Like, how did you kind of drive through to kind of realize your ambitions at such a young age from being a teenager?
I guess that, you know, what's the biggest obstacle? Getting on the water. You know, I was a kid from Derbyshire, I had no money. I'd saved up for a tiny little dinghy that was 8 foot long. That wasn't going to take me anywhere. So, you know, how do you get to the point where you can actually be on the water? You know, I couldn't drive, I couldn't get to the coast. I was completely dependent on my parents who were incredibly busy and ran a small holding with animals. So they weren't going to run me all over the country. So I guess one of the challenges was, you know, how do I get to the water? And I ended up working with a sailing school on the northeast coast. I went to do a course there. I learnt how to navigate. I learnt how to operate a radio. And when I was 17, only I think 6 months after I took the radio course, I went to that school and I taught it. I was petrified. I was teaching adults. I was 17 years old. I'd only just come out of A-levels at school, which I barely passed because I ended up with glandular fever. So I had this whole catalogue of things. But I was in a sailing school and I was learning, and I just made a point of asking every question I could. I asked about everything. I wanted to know everything. I would stay up late. I slept on the radio room floor in a sleeping bag. I used to play on the software which taught you about lights and sounds in the fog, which you have to learn. And I just played for hours on them to learn everything I possibly could. And I guess to your point about what are the barriers, I didn't see them. Obviously, they were there. You know, you have to. But when you have a goal, everything you do, you try to take a step that gets you one stage closer to that goal. So you don't really see the barriers. You just try to find the pathways. That's where your life is focused. And never for a second, not once did the fact I was female ever cross my mind. It was not even it was just irrelevant in what I was trying to do. I never thought about it. In fact, even now when you ask the question, and I've been asked many times now through the sailing, so, you know, what was it like to be the only female competitor and the youngest competitor and all that stuff. And I remember the first time I was asked that, and I was like, I don't know. I'm here to do the race like everyone else. How do I know? I mean, how does that bloke down there feel? I'm sure I feel just the same. I did not have a position on it and almost felt that's not a real question because why would I be any different?
So switching to the big races, the Vendée de l'Aube first time, you came second, and then the speed one, which was the harder?
The round the world record was by far the hardest. I mean, that doesn't mean to say the Vendée Globe was easy. It was 3 months at sea on a boat racing against 24 other competitors, and much of which was in the Southern Ocean. So it's all pretty hardcore. But there are some real differences. The Vendée Globe, it's a bit like a World Rally Series. You're all in very similar boats. They're not identical, but they're designed to a rule. So everyone races in a 60-foot boat. The masts are similar heights. The boats are similar widths. They're similar speeds through the design, but you can tweak it. So when you're out there and you're racing against other people that are physically out on the water with you. Now, in a record attempt, that's completely different. You're in a boat that has no rules. There are no regulations. You build the biggest, fastest thing you possibly think will make it around the world, you know, with you alive on it. And then you launch it, and then you train with it, and then you set off. And when we designed and built that boat, nobody had ever in history made it around the world in a multi-hull non-stop solo. Multi-hulls are three bits of boats or two bits of boats. They're very, very powerful. They're incredible machines. They flip upside down really easily. 2003, we flipped one in 5 seconds with five of us on board. It was a 60-foot boat, and she was just like that. And so you know you're on the edge all the time. They don't have a big lump of weight underneath them to keep them the right way up, so they're inherently very dangerous. So the record was different, A, because the boat was, I mean, you could say lethal. Yeah. I mean, you try and make it as safe as you can, but we were trying to do something that had never been done before. The second point was, whilst we were building that boat, a Frenchman took a boat that had been sailed around the world non-stop by a crew of 10, and he took the record that I was kind of trying to break, which was 93 days, held by a monohull, and I was trying to think, well, maybe we could make, if I can get around the world, if I can get this boat around the world, maybe I could do 80 days. That would be amazing. You know, the Phileas Fogg 80 days, it's a bit mythical. Maybe I'll do that. If I can get round alive. And then this guy takes this boat that no one thought he'd make it on, because it's just not designed to be sailed on your own, and he got round in 72 days. And so the bar was way, way higher than it had been when we'd been just trying to get around the world, and I had to push that boat incredibly hard to have any chance of breaking the record, because I was 75 feet, he was 90. And then the other element is that once someone's established a record, it's in stone. It doesn't go away. It's not like a race where the person in front of you could have a problem, or you know there could be a failure in their systems and you could overtake them. That time is set in stone. It never stops. It's an average speed. It just keeps going. When you stop, it keeps going. It will never stop. And that's really different mentally. There's no one else there. You know, you're racing yourself. You're racing the clock. You're racing something that really never stops, won't have a problem, and won't go away.
And that all happened quite quickly, didn't it? Because it was 93 days for a while, then he came in, like smashed it, and then you were going soon after.
I went the winter after, yeah. You have to go in the winter.
You're describing in the Southern Ocean, it's like driving a car, you're driving a car 20 miles an hour, you can turn the radio on, everything is great, and you're hanging out, looking around, and then try it at 70, 80, 90, 120, it gets harder, it gets white knuckles, and then the Southern Ocean is, you know, try doing that in the dark, take the wipers off, take the headlights off, it's raining, the fog, everything. So describe this, the Southern Ocean. I guess one of the questions I was going to ask you is, do you ever feel like giving up? But I guess you can't when you're in the Southern Ocean. So, because it's 4 days from anywhere. How do you mentally gear yourself up for the Southern Ocean, particularly when you've gone through it once before and you know what to expect a little bit?
I think you described it really well, actually. that analogy of, you know, going fast and not being able to see anything for half the time because it's dark is, you know, you're living in that. You know, you're trying to sleep in that for 10 minutes, 20 minutes. You're, you know, all day, all night, that boat's going. There's no moment at night where you think, I'll put my pyjamas on now and have a little kip in my sleeping bag. It never stops. You know, you drive the boat with an autopilot or you steer by hand. You're navigating, you're checking the weather, you're checking the boat. There is no let up at all. That's one element of the Southern Ocean. And I guess the way you prepare, the way you deal with it is that you are so focused on what you're trying to achieve, the big picture, that helps you massively deal with the hardships and the scary bits. I mean, there were times when it was really likely I wasn't going to make it, quite frankly. You know, there was Christmas Eve. I was down in a massive storm in the Southern Ocean. There'd been a secondary depression built on the depression I was on. It got deeper and deeper. There was 80 knots behind me. A boat like I was in couldn't survive 80 knots. You know, you can't.
You were racing ahead of it, weren't you?
I was racing ahead of it. You'd be, you know, if it rolled over the top of you, you would be smashed to bits upside down. I mean, it's just, you don't want to go there. And I had to stay north, or at least go due east to keep, to stop myself from sliding down and it running over me, because as you go south, the wind changes and it pushes you south. And so it means you have to sail much closer to the wind than you want. It's incredibly aggressive. The waves are smashing the boat, but you have to go fast as you physically can. And you just, you can't sleep, you can't, you know, you don't want to eat, you just, you are absolutely living on adrenaline. And that's pretty full on. And how do you deal with that? Well, you're doing what you love, you chose it. You know, you want to be there, you know, however hard it is, I always used to say, well, you know, today's a bit tricky, but tomorrow's going to be better. And you just, you live in the moment. And you know, for me, it's about, you deal with it by checking everything you can. Right, what can go wrong? What can go wrong? Check, what can go wrong? You know, are the batteries okay? Are the sails okay? Is there any chafe? You know, is there any water sitting in the mainsail? Does it need draining out? And you spend hours just making sure, just checking, just trying to predict what might go wrong, because things always do. The reality is things always do. And that, it keeps you incredibly focused on what you can do, because there's always a risk in those situations. You focus on what you can't. You know, I've got friends who have rung home and said goodbye from boats and come home. And you think, I've always felt, how can you do that? Because I would never think I couldn't get out of it. I just can't imagine that you would ever think this is it. There'd always be something that you would do, even if it was the last thing and you ended up dying. You'd always, your mentality, I'd always think there's always something else you can do. And that's what you do in that situation. You do everything you possibly can to improve your chances, to keep the boat the right way up, to keep things in one piece, to not smash things to bits. You know, in that particular scenario, if I'd have had a failure, I wouldn't be here. So you've got to be, you've got to live on your toes.
Now, I guess switching gears a little bit, 2010 was a big year for you. You retired from professional sailing to set up the foundation and to focus on, you know, educating all of us on the circular economy, what it means for plastics and how we can function better. But my first question before we get into the detail of that is, what was your mindset in terms of making that transition?
I never ever thought I would, you know, begin to study global economics or, you know, how finance shifts the global economy or how materials flow through a global economy. I mean, that was not my space. I'm not an expert in that. I never thought I'd do that. I never ever thought I would leave sailing, not for a second. And so, you know, how was that transition? That transition actually began with curiosity that I couldn't leave behind. It was that feeling that you sail around the world on a boat, you're 2,500 miles away from the nearest town, what you have is all you have, you can't stop and buy more, you realise what finite is. And I made that parallel between the global economy, suddenly thinking, and it was great, you know, you kind of suddenly comes in your head, but hang on, isn't the world the same? We have finite resources available to us once in the history of humanity, and yet doesn't our global economic model use them up? When we make money, when we create growth, don't we use that stuff up? How can that work in the long term? Because on my boat, I know when I'm going to run out. And it was just a tiny thought. It was right at the back of my brain. I was racing. I was living the dream. I didn't want to stop, but I couldn't let it go. And I started to learn more. And I started to learn about energy and the energy transition and more about materials and how we use materials and how many years left we have of materials. And I kind of went on this journey slightly in the background. And the more I learned, the more I realized, you know, this is the biggest challenge I've ever come across. Why isn't everyone talking about this? Now, this is the future of our economy. This is the future of us, employment, humanity. I mean, this is, it's quite a big deal. And the more I read, the more I just became absolutely fascinated by this question. So, you know, if the way we use materials today is consumptive and extractive, which it is, you know, we use them up effectively. We try and use them up a bit less, bit less quickly, but we do use them up. If that's our economic model, that doesn't run in the long term. And what fascinated me and was this little thought at the back of my mind came right to the front of my mind was, so what works? What works for our global economy? What economic model works? And I felt, to be honest, very out of place because, you know, who was I to be asking these questions? I was just a sailor. I mean, no one had any idea I was interested in this. And the more you learn, the more you learn, the more you get into it. And I kind of got to the point where I thought, you know, I'm going to have to work on this. And I thought, should I sail around the world with a boat with a message? Because that would be great. I could, you know, use what I do well and had been successful in. I could have probably, you know, finding sponsorships incredibly hard. It's probably the hardest thing you'll ever do in a project. And I was in a position where I could more easily have found sponsorship. But you sail around the world with a boat with a message on. What's the message? I had no idea. Use less? That's not great, is it? That's certainly not the solution. And I just thought, well, what is the solution? And I couldn't put that down. And I made the decision. It was the hardest decision I've ever made in my life, which was to walk away from sailing.
Could you tell us a little bit about the foundation, how it started, its focus, so maybe a little bit of the circular versus the linear to kind of educate the audience?
I started speaking to more and more people. I started reading books. I started to try and understand different schools of thought. How do people think about this? You know, people must have been thinking about this for many, many years. And I came across some experts, some CEOs who'd been working with scientists who thought differently. I started looking at cradle-cradle design, biomimicry, industrial symbiosis, performance economy, sharing economy, all these ideas, and started to kind of see this distillation of the line, the straight linear line that our economy is still predominantly, where we take a material out of the ground, we make something out of it, and then ultimately we throw the product away. We recycle some of it, for sure, but not by intent. We kind of get what we can out of it at the end. We don't design it at the beginning to do that.
Yeah.
And our model, so many of the CEO conversations that I was having was, we're going to make a car with a bit less material, with a bit less energy, and that'll make us a little bit more resilient from the volatility in material prices. And I remember a conversation with the chief exec saying that the average EU car manufacturer had to endure a raw material price increase of 500 million euros in 12 months. And you have no control over that. And that's half your operating profit just gone. That's a massive risk in a linear economy. What if you could isolate yourself from that? What if you could start to be more resilient? What if you could shift that line, that linear line, whereby you try and get a bit more out of it every year, which we've been very good at, but are beginning to bump up against our limits? What if you turn that into a circle? What if you design everything so you can get the materials back out and make the next product out of it? What if you design everything so you can remanufacture it and keep its value higher for longer? What if you can regenerate natural systems through collecting food waste, human waste, anything biological, you know, cotton, all of that biodegrades and goes back to farming, which is not the case today. We reckon we've got 60 harvests left because our farmland can't hold water, because it's dry, because we don't put biomass on it. The biological material ends up creating eutrophication because it leaks out of rivers. All our soils disappearing. That's quite a big deal for food in the future. What if you could regenerate it? You know, there's so much talk about, let's make it last a bit longer. Let's use a little bit less of this. But actually, that just buys you time. And what fascinated me was in the transition to what. And when I started to speak to people about this different idea, you know, this circular model rather than this linear model, you start to think, well, actually, that is a circular economy, not a linear economy, and that's regenerative and restorative, and that's all about innovation and creativity and intelligent design. Why would you design a piece of plastic packaging to keep a chicken fresh for 5 days and then become waste? It's useless. There's nothing you can do with it. You can't recycle it. It is waste. It will be incinerated or it will be landfilled. That's what happens to the majority in this country. You know, we're quite good at recycling the things we can recycle, but the fact is lots of plastic was never designed to be recyclable. Why would you design waste in a finite world? And you start to see that it's everything from plastic to vehicles to jet engines to the way we generate income from cities. You know, we build stuff, we use stuff, and then we worry about it later. And is there a way of decoupling economic growth from the resource constraints through using materials, not using them up? And I created the foundation in September 2010 after 3 years of research with the goal to accelerate the transition to a circular economy. I remember being asked by a journalist at the launch of the foundation, so what are you actually trying to achieve? And I said, well, I suppose when you look at it bluntly, we're trying to shift a global economic model from linear to circular. And I almost felt a bit strange saying that because that was quite a big challenge. But you think that's actually what has to happen if we're going to have a regenerative economy.
In this kind of stuff, it's easy to say it's somebody else's problem.
Or opportunity.
This is true. But, you know, and I guess here on the home front, we've kind of done a few small things, elimination, kind of doing recycling stuff. Mm. But as individuals, you know, what's your advice to individuals in terms of behavioral change and grassroots? Like, how do you approach it when you talk to an individual level?
You're talking about shifting from linear to circular. Obviously, everyone plays a role in that. You can't say that's not down to the individual. Of course it is. But right now, even if all of us said we want to be circular tomorrow, you can't be. Because the system won't enable it. Because most of the plastic packaging, we still buy our stuff in, which if you try really hard, you can avoid most of, but not all. But the fact is, it's not designed to fit within a circular economy. So where we sit is going to the beginning of the pipe, changing the system, getting everyone in the room, and making those choices available to everyone. So when you get your plastic, it's obvious what you do with it. That's recyclable, that's compostable, and that's reusable, so it goes back. Job done. Simple. That enables significant grassroots change. There's a lot of work to be done to understand the risk and return. But then I'd always ask the question of, you know, so if linear doesn't work in the long run, and I've yet to be completely challenged on that, obviously it's worked for a while since the Industrial Revolution, but actually using things up forever is not going to work in a finite world with a growing population. What's the risk of that versus the risk of circular? Obviously there are many risk indices and we need to understand a huge amount more about that, but there are enablers everywhere. You know, grassroots is not just individuals in their homes, it's you guys, it's everyone, it's the global economy itself.
Okay, Ellen, thanks.
Thank you.
For being here. It's been a real pleasure. Positive, forward-looking, upbeat on what is a complicated topic.
It is, but it's all about opportunity.
There you go.